行政院政务委员唐凤唐政委，还有我们今天大树论坛的另外一位主讲人詹宏志董事长。那我们行政院中小企业处的经济部中小企业处的副处长胡贝利副处长。来自我们法国在台协会 Director Casabon， 还有我们澳洲驻台代表Mr. Cohen。 非常高兴，那么还有在场各位贵宾，那我们是不是邀请我们副处长跟大家问候一下？
非常开心大家来到我们社创中心，也非常感谢两位大师今天来做我们大师分享的论坛的主题。那希望今天大家在这边就是收获满满，疫情中间大家都有更多的信心来应对这个疫情的挑战。谢谢，
非常感谢。那接下来我们要做一个拍照的那个环节啊，所以是不是请？
我们先请那个胡处长，然后还有我们唐凤政委，然后我们詹宏志董事长。And now it's the time for taking the group photo, so we are going to invite the director of first office and Mr. Gary on the stage for the whole group photo. Thank you. 那我们现场的媒体记者朋友。那我们现在就开始我们的大合照仪式。那我们现场有主办单位的摄影师。是非常难得的机会，两位大师莅临现场，然后接下来会有非常精彩的论坛。
Very special moment to have all of you here to participate in this.
好，我们现在都 OK 了哈。好，那我们有请贵宾回座 ，please back to the seat. And we are going to take the other photo for the whole participants here today. 那我们现场摄影师麻烦大家看往前看。好，再一张哦，谢谢。好，那我们接下来就把主持棒交给文良。那接下来我们的大师论坛就要正式开始。Now is the time to kick off the whole ceremony. Thank you.
好，非常感谢大家的莅临。那我们今天的这个论坛呢，特别邀请到两位大师哦，那分别是不同时代的网络知名的，有人说是先知，或者是说那个先驱了啊。那特别是我们这次关于台湾的疫情控制啊，引起世界各国的重视。那究竟在这当中，我们偶然的发现了，原来有这么多潜在的力量，让台湾的无论是跨专业、跨系统跟跨产业的合作，可以为我们带来这样的成果。所以我想今天我们特别请到唐凤政委，还有我们詹宏志董事长来为大家进行这样的一个论坛的目的。那我们是不是现在邀请两位上台来就座啊？那我们当然照例啊，在开始的时候要邀请两位，那么先给我们破题，关于社会创新啊 ，social innovation。那我们是先从政委开始啊。
要再选吗？对。
那您怎么看社会创新这个题目？
大家好，非常高兴能够来这边哦。社会创新有一个简单的记忆的方式，就是众人之事，众人助之哦。就 就是关于整个社会的事情，然后所有人都可以来一起来帮助。这个跟产业创新就好像是社会的两个翅膀一样，在产业创新那边，大家想的是说怎么样子去把一个已经定义好的市场需要的产品或者是服务把它做到最好。但是呢，社会创新是把社会的潜在的需要，大家还不确定说，哎，我们到底要怎么样达成的，集思广益，让任何人都可以去完成。那我们这边通常在讲社会创新的时候，用的是联合国的永续发展目标。那大家可以看到这些小拼图、小方块，好比像说联合国永续发展目标里面的第三项，就是在告诉大家说，哎，我们用各种各样的方法确保大家的健康。那确保大家健康的方法就有很多。那这次的疫情，当然关于口罩的社会创新就非常多。好比像说，大家可能还会想到粉红色的口罩，这个就是一个社会创新，因为其实它并不是一个产品或者一个是服务啊，这是一个改变大家看口罩的方式，运用电波来重复利用口罩啊，这也是一个社会创新，因为这毕竟不是大同电锅推出来或国宝电锅推出来的新的产品或服务线啊，这个是运用现有的产业这边的能力、服务等等，去创造一个完全新的、本来设计人都没有想到的社会价值。那对我来讲，这个就是一个社会创新。当然，它会带动像我们第十七项就是全世界的合作，以及第九项就是创新跟工业化，这些也都是永续发展的目标。当然，都是以不牺牲后代子孙作为最基本的概念。
好，谢谢政委。那董事长，
谢谢。社会创新和社会企业啊，都是过去这十几年全世界的新的议题。一个讲的是实践啊，一个讲的是组织啊。那这个实践是把过去我们认识的各式各样想要改造社会的那些悲怨啊，用一个非常积极的突破性的方式来工作，跳脱过去的框架，跳脱过去的方法啊。那希望能够得到一个更好的这个对社会有效的结果啊。那这个创新的途径有可能来自于个人，有可能来自于组织。那过去我们以为这个社会目的的组织通常是 non-profit organization， 那现在我们也认识，其实也仍然有可能用一个企业的形式来进行啊。所以不只是社会企业，现在有了一个新的一个努力目标，那甚至也有这样子专门针对社会企业的投资方啊，有了这样子创投这样子的基金啊。所以全世界对自己的社会的改良的这个愿望，是不断的在演化当中。我想台湾在这一次的这个新冠肺炎的疫情过程，我们看到这个藏在民间的力量，因为这个社会创新它的一个特质就是来自于民间社会，由下而上。但是台湾的历史上不一定啊，因为有唐凤做内应嘛，所以是里应外合嘛，是有一个在政府里卧底的人啊，所以当时一个更有意思的方式啊。我觉得在这次里面，这些大大小小的创新，有时候是很小的创新，我觉得给社会很大的这个安慰感啊，就特别是关于那个讯息的共鸣啊，我对。口罩地图也印象深刻，就是说在那个大家每天都不知道去哪里找口罩的时候，口罩地图的出现，我每天打开来发现我家附近的药局里面还有人拥有500个口罩，有300个口罩，心理上那种安定感胜过我真的走出去买这个实际上就是让你知道，就是一切讯息都是透明的。那我想这些众多的社会创新当中，显然未来有一个时间，那个数位形式的创新一定会带来很多的可能。就好像说数位的技术的介入，使过去我们所熟悉的每一个企业领域都起了变化一样。我觉得过去的所有的社会运动的意愿，也都会包含了一部分的社会的包含的数位的表达，数位的创新的可能性。我就今天也因为从来宾当中想到一个数位创新的一个 特别有趣的例子，这就是 LINE 啊。LINE 的出现是日本311的大海啸的时候，因为那个灾情太严重了，所以这一个工具做出来的时候，原来是一个社会目的的，是要给灾区的人啊彼此可以沟通、可以联系、可以寻找家人啊。那后来发展成一个这个非常伟大的事业啊。不过说，即使它没有发展成后来这么成功的事业，那个 LINE 已经是历史上值得一记的一个受教育的学习。所以我觉得也许这个也都是一个很好的启发，和未来我们有很多的形式的社会创新可能会被有关。
好，非常感谢两位的开场啊。那一会儿要有技术问题要提醒一下，所以我们等一下麦克风的时候稍微接近接近一点，因为我们现场收音后方的那个因为只有环境音的影响。好，好，那所以刚刚提到了关于社会创新的定义，那这次啊，特别我们因为疫情的关系，刚刚詹董事长提到了，那么 LINE 是因为311地震意外的那么带来一些效果。人类历史上有时候在危机的时候产生的一些技术，比如说两次世界大战，后来我们带来了航空的科技，还有后来网络的科技也带来全球化。那这次的疫情，那么究竟从台湾的因应措施里面，我们产生一个非常强大的信心，台湾 can help 啊。事实上，我们提出台湾 can help 已经有一段时间。那这次我们有非常多具体的技术跟经验可以谈到这一点，那是不是我们就请唐凤政委来给我们谈一谈？尤其特别最近非常多的媒体、非常多的会议，比如说看到我们政委在这边加班到很晚啊，那叫了 Uber Eats 那继续在做那个 conference call 啊，非常辛苦，但是在传播台湾 can help 的经验。
是，确实啊，我现在常常一大早就来这边，然后因为一大早的时候才是每周的不管东岸还是西岸最恰当的一个时间，所以一来这边就去开这个研讨会。那然后上班上完一天之后还得回这边来，因为那个时候是欧洲这个特别偏好的时间，然后再跟欧洲跟非洲开研讨会。所以确实是数位政委就是不止一位嘛，数位就是很多位的意思。对，任何地方的这个住处啊，外交人员都知道说，只要把机器人或者是把网纱的那个全息投影的设备准备好，他只要一按召唤呢，我就会出现在他的面前，而且他还不用去机场接机，这个也是一个社会创新了。那其实他不用去机场接机是很 serious， 因为我在之前我就已经因为我调时差，身体体质上调得很慢，以及不愿意造成额外的二氧化碳排放，所以只要是有这种就是远程的，我能够远距出席的，我就发展了非常多远距出席的技术，这个也不是秘密，大家也都知道了。那但是我很欣慰的就是说，现在数位不止一位，因为疫情的关系，全世界的人都发现说，我们视讯见面呢、可能以前说见面三分情，视讯两分情嘛，好像打个折扣，但是呢在很多国家现在见面要戴口罩，所以只剩一分情嘛，视讯还好一点。所以这个时候我们在台湾这边，我们就有很多新的创新的模式，好比像说在中期处的协助之下，其实过去两年我们都是巡回全台湾嘛，贝蒂常常跟我一起去巡回，可是同仁并没有跟着下去，而是我们透过这种视讯连接的技术，去把这个社创中心跟全台湾的还有五个这些社创的基地全部连线成一个大的虚拟的空间，在里面开会。这样子的技术现在就变得非常的有用，不但是我们自己就是内部的像总统贝蒂克总等等去运用，我们往外部的好比像说在 WHA 的前两三天，我们在卫福部的那个大会议室里面有我们的指挥官主持，我们就自己开了一个 WHA 的会前会啊，那大概有14个理念相近的这个国家跟经济体，那也做了非常多意见的交换，而且我们的网络连线比后面那个要稳很多。我的意思是说，你越习惯说透过这样子网络的方式、数位的方式打破时间跟空间的限制，那在这波疫情来的时候，其实数位转型它变成一个新的契机，因为在以前最困难的是你说服你的利害关系人用这一套新的东西，而他的脑里面可能还是五年前、十年前的那个视讯会抽格啊，很难过的那种状态。但是现在等于就一次，所有人把脑里的快取都清除了，大家就发现说，哦，原来远端透过像扩增实境等等的技术，其实感觉真的跟医疗现场差不了多少。所以这个打破时间跟空间的限制，以及在这种小型波 边关系里面，我们因此重做一个国际秩序，因为毕竟在线上的会议你也不知道哪些是正式，哪些是观察员，每一个都是一个小视窗而已哦。像这样子的一些新的方法，其实就是可以打破我们以前外交上面的一个很大的一个困难。所以其实我们现在台湾 can help 已经多加了一个词，叫做台湾 is helping。 如果现在大家到 Twitter 上面找台湾 is helping 的话，大家就会发现说，哦，有非常非常多的东西，像我们刚刚讲到的，从这个健康的口罩的社会创新带到这个工业化，现在他们已经在整场输出了，任何地方只要给足够的水啊、电啊、厂区的这个供应，我们口罩国家队就整场帮你建一个24小时运转，每天可以产200万片医疗口罩，或者你要变成 N95 或什么其他的都可以的这样子一种技术。那这个技术，我们之前大家透过那个 app， 就是把自己的心意贡献出来，然后要求外交部去援助全世界的这些医生跟护士，那个就产生了一个叫做试吃包的一个作用，就大家就发现说台湾出去的品质真的非常好，静电放很久都不会没电啊。所以这样子的情况下，他们就现在就非常愿意的来把这个整场输出的技术把它导出，所以这个我们可以看到社会创新也是可以带动产业创新。
刚刚提到的就是在这个疫情当中，我们意外的发现产业输出的一个机会啊。那不晓那个过去詹董事长曾经提过，就是支持破坏性的创新，让我们旧的一些方式可以带来新的能力，这样的一个观点啊。那您怎么看？特别在这次的疫情当中看见的数位社会创新的机会？
我觉得本来是一个人伦悲剧，或后来变台湾的一个力量。我意思说，在我这个小时候啊，年轻的时候，我们在台湾所有的优秀的男生都被要求去练理工科。这个概念到今天为止没有完全消失啊。就觉得如果你跑去练非理工科，一定是 something wrong with you， 我你一定做错了什么事啊。那像我就不是念理工科的，就最后我就是必须要用雇用很多工程师来作为一个替代。那我说因为这个缘故，所以我过去在做很多事的时候，就意识到台湾有一个很奇特的优势，就是你这个社会充满了大量的物美价廉的工程师，他很优秀，他有很好的工程师的文化。工程师的文化就是对每开发一个任何一个东西，它都有严谨的步骤。那这个东西是在这个在社会里面是已经变成社会的基因的一部分。这个解释了台湾在国际分工里面，本来做篮球、做雨伞啊，做圣诞灯，后来做纺织品，一路走，最后做到电脑。做到电脑之后，这整个 IT 产业在台湾就不早了，它就一路往上升级。最后你会出现像富国神机这样的公司啊，有世界一流的水准的这样子的制造业。那我可以这样说，80年代，如果你要站在这个新竹的那块天地里头，规划者说，我将要把这个地方变成全世界最重要的资讯产品的生产地，你会听起来像是一个空话，像是个谎言啊。但我想说，就是新竹科学园区了啊。80年的时候，你看全世界跟资讯相关的技术、基础技术都不在台湾啊，我们也没有任何背景，不过我们有强而有力的工程师的文化。从土木工程、机械工程到后来的微电子工程，台湾一直都拥有非常非常多的人才。我在1996年创业，第一个事业是做一本电脑杂志，我就注意到说，我可以在台湾可以找到一流的工程师，就是可以把电脑拆开又重组的那样的人，他又很会写文章。我后来把这个杂志拿去香港办的时候，就发现，在香港找这样的人是很难的啊，但是台湾这是很多的，就是有很多学电机，但他是一个文青啊，因为他们人口是过多了啊， 是按照人口比例是更多的。那可是香港也许你可以找到啊，会写文章又是金融专家啊，那个时候的选择。所以我觉得如果未来啊，台湾在各式各样的创新，不管是产业上的或者是社会上的，它里面包含了各式各样的啊这个社会的人才，我不会感到惊讶，因为这有一个很长的社会基础，它有哇五六十年的社会基础啊，它是一个根深蒂固的文化。但我说这本来是人伦悲剧了，把一些并不喜欢理工的感觉变理工科，不一定是好消息。不过，但是最后结果是台湾这部分是非常强的。那后来我有一些机会，因为机会跟很多国际组织打交道的时候，就意识到我就觉得在台湾不困难的啊，社会人才的集结跟啊去处理一个案子，或者我们已经非常熟练的某些工作，在某些国家里面并不容易啊。那在那些国家，它甚至还缺少一种很强的经济动力去鼓励这个数位的创新。比如说在中国大陆，在美国，可能数位上创新有很高的期望值，因为你可能会回业出一个 Amazon 这样的公司，回业出一个阿里巴巴这样的公司，所以那个物质的报酬非常非常非常大，所以它有一个动力去鼓励它做这个事。可是如果你身在巴布瑞米第一名或以上，你怎么可能在那里create 一个 internet company 会得到全世界资本市场的祝福，你是不会的啊。你甚至连那个环境都极可能是跟你是十分不利的。我说相形之下，这些数位发展有它的难度的国家，就我会把大部分的国家放在你这个 category， 那它要应用台湾所发展出来的技术，就相对的比采用大国家大市场发展出来的技术更为可能。也就是台湾也许环境上要产生一个像 Google 像阿里巴巴这么大的公司是不容易的啊，在台湾你即使是很努力很聪明，这个环境也不容易让你做到这个事。可是因为你必须很认真的是解决一个小问题，你用社会工具去解决一个社会上有需求的问题，它规模不大，我可以生产。那这些东西，我感觉全世界可能有另外至少200个国家是跟台湾处境是相近的，所以台湾的 model 对他来说是很容易很大，但大陆跟美国的经验是不容易学习的，因为他需要一个很特别的市场。那我会说，目前在台湾发生的事啊，我说我们当时 come a long way 啊，我们可以今天可以说台湾 can help。因为其实在2003年的时候，我们是台湾 need help， 对不对？我们那时候是希望加入 WTO 而不可得，希望得到跟全世界其他国家一样流通的 information 而不可得啊。那今天在这个很特别的新冠肺炎的过程当中，台湾过去的某些累积，譬如说数位能力的累积，医疗系统的累积一样的，我们把最优秀的人赶去变医生了啊，所以医生是台湾一群最优秀的人啊，所以大量的医生他们都是非常聪明、非常逻辑、非常好的人。当他们要做公共卫生的规划的时候，他们其实是有一种聪明，能找到各种方法。所以今天的这一个能力，当然被看见，我都回头想。我们回头看，其实都有起码有40年以上的历史，都不是没有原因啊。那这些力量看起来，我说台湾一样的，台湾不是一个不是一个在世界上可以完全自给自足的社会，它一定要变成社会和世界分工的一部分，它必须去帮助别人，它必须得到别人的帮助啊。那我想，我们现在是有机会把能够帮助的那几个途径看得更加明朗。
是，像您刚刚提到非常重要啊。我们过去很容易因为身处在中美两大国之间，那么忽略了其实跟台湾无论在人口上或者是在地理环境上面，跟国土的大小上面类似的国家，我们的经验可能相较于中美两大国，可更为大部分国家可适用啊。那比如说像光是我们的人口数， 等于是澳洲这么大土地的人口一样，那我们的国土范围跟荷兰差不多，所以很多的国际上的经验，可能台湾的民众要跳脱中美两大国的这种视野之外，去寻找更多其他的可能性。那不晓得从政委关于江董事长的回应，你有什么样的看法？
对，我觉得非常棒哦，这是很好的一个观察。当然，我很难讲40年的这个历史，因为我还不到40岁。但是，我很同意，就是说，从我一出生下来，感觉到的社会氛围就是台湾不管哪一个角落了，如果它连不上网络，或者是它没有好的医疗资源或没有好的教育资源，那就是大家的一个共同的耻辱的这种感觉。就是不管在偏乡，不管在资源少的地方，我们都一定要确保最基本的通讯、健康、教育等等的这些权利。那这个确实，如果你的面积非常非常大的话，那成本就会因此非常非常高。那在台湾，因为人口相当的密集了，所以确实它就形成一种文化。那这种文化其实是很特别的，就是大家都会在意彼此，大家都会帮彼此去做设想，帮彼此去做一些计划啊。那然后，因为我的兴趣当然是 programming， 那这个在很多其他的国家是被当作一种就是工程的，就是工程师。那但是在台湾，因为我们当年把 programming 翻进来的时候，选了城市设计的这样子一个翻译啊，而不是资讯工程这样子一个翻译。资讯工程师可能到高教的时候才会用的字啊。那所以呢，我就发现说，哎，设计的这个领域它是比较不受传统的东西去规范的，因为设想跟计划你可以在任何的地方来做。那后来我们就发现说，哎，在我们这一次的疫情里面，我们碰到了非常多这个社会设计、机制设计、互动设计等等的这些高手。他有些就是就像那个刚刚这个大师说的，其实是就也是我们吴任所大师、社会大师所说的是，他本来是医生或者是工程师，可他脑子这个不断的在想是怎么样子是 for purpose 然后 with profit。那这个想法就跟很多其他地方不一样，很多其他想法是他先 for profit， 他钱赚够了，然后再 with purpose 啊去做一些社会责任等等。但是我们这边不管是工程师也好，医师也好，当他在进行一个设计的策划的时候，往往都是先去想说我怎么样照顾到所有的人，那这个就是 with 就是 for purpose 嘛。但在过程里面，哎，我还是找到一些经济模式出来，所以就是 with profit。那这个其实也是为什么我们在做设计的推行的时候，我们一直讲说它是社会跟企业这两个不同视角中间的连接，那这个连接当然就是创新。但是这种创新的连接方式，在台湾是你随便找任何一个人，他都会很同意说啊，当然啊，企业本来就是应该这个要来照顾社会，来解决社会的问题，解决社会的需求。如果这个企业他没有解决社会问题或需求的话，甚至有时候还会被抵制。那台湾的社会抵制能力又是特别强的，所以我们的做法就是说，把这个非常强的抵制的这个功能啊，去把它稍微扭转一下，变成选择性购买这个。选择性的支持、群众募资等等，所以即使像我们的外交工作，就是大使可能也知道，我们现在在这个外交、数位外交上面最强的，其实并不是外交部，而是一群这个乌合之众啊。那就是透过群众募资的方法，然后忽然之间就要在《纽约时报》上面登广告，然后一下就募到非常非常多的人的钱，然后本来写了一封说实话有点中二的这样子一个信，想要 po 在全世界上面，然后就有大量的这个朋友，这个马上帮他们踩刹车，说你这样子 po 出去实在是不是很 OK， 所以他们就紧急的在24小时之内，透过不断的跟这些利害关系人有出钱募资的人对话，一直去送这个民意调查表等等的方式，然后就似乎在24小时里面就变成一个比较成熟的人，然后这样子出来的那个讯息就是 Who can help Taiwan 的这样的一个讯息就永贞。他们设计那个讯息，哎，突然之间就让我们在国际上面有一个很明确的定位，而且任何人，他只要到台湾 can help that us， 马上就可以看到所谓的台湾模式到底是怎么一回事，有什么具体的帮助。我们之前的副总统陈建仁院士，他就是《流行病学》这本书的作者，他还录了一个很简单的，我也有看，大概20000人有看的这样子一个数位的一个叫做 Crash Course on Epidemiology， 就是传染病学、流行病学的入门。那这个入门呢，也已经翻成就是英语啊，现在好像还有各国语言了。所以一时之间，我们这个讯息就非常明确的出去，就在台湾的产业界也好，或者是我们这些设计师也好，任何人在做事情呢，都是先想 purpose， 那我们终于找到这样子一个语汇，这样子一个 vocabulary， 这一套讲法，说我们讲的每件事情，我们本来只是解决台湾的社会环境或经济的结构问题，但我们现在透过联合国永续发展目标，把我们正在解决的变成大家都一下就可以按图索骥找得到的这个语言。那这样子的话，我们传递出去台湾 is helping 的这个 hashtag 的时候，每一个国家都可以去看说，哎，某一部分我们马上就可以来采用。那这样的话，台湾它就变成一个观念，它变成一个容易流传的这样子一种创新的一种模式。那这个才是我觉得台湾 model 真正重要的一个部分，不是说这个珍珠奶茶到底要用黑珍珠还是白珍珠，或者它这个调和的比例是什么，它是一个原来珍珠可以放在奶茶里面的这样一个概念。然后像我去非洲的时候，他们都问说，哎，我们怎么样把这个我们南非国宝茶还是什么东西弄成像你们珍珠奶茶一样知名啊？那我就跟他们说，这样子的开放式的创新其实才是最重要的台湾模式的一个部分。
刚刚政委提到的特别反映出我们对我个人来讲新时代的各种创意来自于社会环境啊的一个浑然天成的这种创意啊。刚刚詹董事长提到啊，我们有过去非常多优秀的男性都读了理工啊，那可能您跟我是少数例外啊，加一。还好他并没有造成人伦悲剧啊，可能有机会变成喜剧。那我们往前去看，这样子的一个趋势，从刚刚政委提到的年轻人共同在网络上透过开放的环境解决各种无论是国际性的问题，或者是我们个别产业突破的问题啊，您怎么看台湾的未来？特别我记得在2014年的那个太阳花运动的时候，您曾经以一个3、4、5年级的角度去省思这样的一件事情，那认为这里面有一些更底层的问题。那从这6年以来的发展，然后再加上这次疫情，你怎么看会对台湾的未来产生什么样的影响？
这题目可能太大了一点，我先能够有机会让我先回应一下这个唐政委的一些想法。我对那个台湾 is helping 这句话啊，我很希望它不是一个事件啊，因为 pandemic 是一个事件，是一个 accident。那这个事件也许很长，也许会很短，这我不知道。可是我们怎么把台湾 is helping 这件事把它变成一个 institution？ 我的看法是说，我们其实从某个角度看，台湾是不需要外交部的，因为我们没有外交可言啊，我们没有邦交国，我们只有朋友啊。所以我一直说，台湾在这个过程当中，比如说我们在第一时间，因为台湾有很好的制造业基础，就很短的时间内就把口罩的生产能力从一天140万变成2000万啊，用很短的时间。这个是很扎实的过去的开工厂、管工厂，处理机械的这个能力啊。这个能力其实有一段时间已经花果飘零了。台湾把这个工厂带着去大陆、去越南、去哪里，台湾工厂已经越来越少。不过这个能力还在啊。这个能力也许在欧洲已经没有了，因为他们没有生产口罩这样的东西，已经几十年了。所以现在要很短的时间把它要回来，它需要很多安排。那台湾还在，这个能力还在，只是我们已经在去年以前，台湾是90%的口罩是进口，但现在自给自足。当我们有能力的时候，我们把口罩拿来帮助朋友，送给美国，送给澳洲，送给每个国家都很感谢啊，因为毕竟这个口罩，特别在医疗体系里面是非常非常重要的啊。街上我们有没有戴，可能关键没有那么严重，可是在医院里头，医生如果没有这些没有这些这个 PPE 啊，就是很危险的。所以当我们有能力给人家这些东西，大家是很 appreciate 的。可是这个是很少的代价，口罩本来是很便宜的东西啊，最近是因为很特别的原因在变贵啊。我们在1月23号以前啊，1月21号以前，我就是1月21号那天晚上， 我的网站上面的半年的口罩的库存一个晚上卖完，因为台湾那一天出现了第一个 case 啊。那那个时候，在那个之前，我们的口罩换算起来我们是三盒150个这样卖的，可能卖200块钱，170块有多少？所以一个口罩只要1块多台币，其实是非常非常便宜的。现在我们要花5块钱啊，我们还是觉得非常便宜的，因为你到全世界去，它可能5块钱美金、5块钱欧元都有可能。那我说这个是一个并不昂贵的代价，如果是朋友，我们很乐意送他啊。那我说台湾其实一直有这样的力量，不是吗？比如说像慈济这样的例子啊，他是哪里有灾难，他就去啊。这个灾难可能在印度，可能在大陆，可能在印尼，第一时间台湾就有某些人道团体，他们就带着所有的救难的物资就去了。所以台湾一直有这样的很强的啊善念，想要帮助别人，也有很多帮助别人的经验。比如说像慈济，他们有很也有很好的 organize 一件事的能力。所以台湾每次有灾难的时候，第一个到达的常常不是政府部门，有可能是慈济啊。那我说，我们为什么不把这样的能力变成一种外交部啊？我们就不争了，就是我们就顶上，我们就认为国家主权这个事都是用来欺负别人的。我们大家不要讨论，我们台湾是超过这个东西。我们只做一件事，是哪里有灾难我们去哪里，哪里有困难我们去哪里。我们用这个来变成我们的外交的标志啊！我们的外交部标志不是要来啊、强调我们的权力，强调啊、争夺一个两个的承认国啊！我会说，当然也可能需要做了，不，我说那现在能做事也多了啊！我们何不做一个名字叫做外交部，但其实它是一个充满了援救性格的一个部门，它是世界上任何有需要我们的地方，我们就带物资、带人、带方法来帮忙。我相信这样子的一个形态，不一定能够扭转这个世界的这个政治的权力结构，不一定可以改变全世界对台湾的观感。那不是只有在疫情这件事上台湾可以 help， 我想在这个每一个社会怎么样消除这个社会的大量的贫穷，台湾是有经验的。怎么样扶持大量的中小企业，台湾是有经验的。怎么样逐步发展出一个有自己的想法的的精致的农业，台湾是有经验的。怎么样发展出一个cost efficient又有涵盖面的医疗体系，台湾是有经验的。台湾有非常多的治国的经验，并不坏，这些东西也很值得带去。我们同一个时间，我们也在学很多国家的东西，但我们有些东西其实是有能力能够带来去帮助别人啊。那这也许我们可以，就是至少我们觉得我们不会对外交觉得那么无力啊，我们有东西可以做。那我再回到跟主持人的问题说，那这件事对台湾的产业或对台湾未来有什么样的这个重大的变化跟影响？你觉得这次这个世界大疫情带来的影响其实可能非常的深远啊，现在还不完全可以看到全貌啊。那至少有两件事我看起来已经觉得惊心动魄啊。第一个是全世界对中国大陆的态度啊，就是我想过去这20-30年的确大家也许并不赞成中国大陆的某些行为或者言论，但大家都忍着啊，我觉得因为你这么大啊，你又那么积极，然后你又有一个那么大的市场，你的市场又有那么多的区隔性啊。我的区隔性意思是说，我也很希望能够去中国大陆做一些事，但不幸我的生涯做的两个行业都是大陆不能容许的。我过去做媒体，现在做网络，都是在大陆最困难的事啊。所以这件事当然也救了我，就我就没有必须从大陆撤退这个问题啊。那我就说， 全世界对大陆现在有一个不同的看法，就是说如果这个国家这么的有影响力，这么的强大，但它的价值、它的体系、它的政治这个结构，跟大部分的民主自由国家这么不一样，那我们应该如何打交道啊？也许各个国家有不同的想法，有的已经很强烈的，比如像美国，有些可能还在观望，像欧洲。那我们说，不管怎么样，每一个社会开始重新考量它跟中国大陆的关系，这件事足以改变全世界的政治风貌。第二个，因为这个态度，因为对中国大陆有一个新的态度，所以你不能够光是想说啊，它有很大的市场，因为有很大的市场，你也不见得能够 access。所以连带的，你对现在整个全世界的生产供应链有这么大的比例、这么大的依赖在中国，这件事可能也有新的想法。也许要把它全部从中国拿出来是很难的，不过要有重新的分配或者有些布局，恐怕是不可避免。当有这个想法的时候，我猜想这是一个很大的啊，这个 war social engineering 啊，因为重组啊，因为今天的这个供应链是花了30年建立起来，就是这么大的对中国依赖的供应链，是从80年代末一直到现在，所以未来如果要把这个改组的重组的，我猜想要花20年，你才会陆陆续续落地。那这工程，因为这工程是跟制造有关，大陆的制造的崛起跟台湾也有密切的关系啊，是台湾人带着工厂跟工厂管理的技术来到中国大陆做投资、做管理、训练当地人。现在大陆的生产能力遍地开花，所以当这一个制造的供应链要全世界重组，它还是需要投资啊，也就是台湾人啊，在各个地方重新去把一个的厂、一个工厂建造起来，从最基本的民生工业的工厂，一直到高科技产品的工厂，其实都用得到啊。我以前在大陆刚刚开放台湾台商刚进到大陆的时候，我当时有一个感触，就是说其实我到每一天都看到台商的角色，包括我去中国大陆每家 internet company 都看到台湾的 engineer 跟台湾的财务人员，就是他需要台湾的人才。那我当时有一个感触，是我开玩笑说了，就从前中国大陆说无徽不成政，没有安徽人没有办法成为市政啊，我觉得中国大陆在那一段发展时间是无台不成政，没有台湾人你没办法发展工业商业。那这一句话过去是针对中国大陆的发展，我说在接下来的20年30年，有可能是在这个供应链重组的，在全世界每一个角落，它都有可能无台不成政。
我想这个也为我们很多无论是新时代也好，或者是台商在寻找新的机会有很大的一个鼓舞跟启示啊。刚偶然发现了您前面提到的关于台湾在世界的角色呢，跟两位今天的头衔的共同性啊，有一点类似啊，就是我们唐政委的那个政务委员，是他的英文名称啊。其实是那个 Minister Without Portfolio， 我们詹大使的吴任所大使是 Ambassador Without Portfolio， 所以我刚刚就在想，我们台湾也可以成为一个 Country Without Portfolio， 但是呢，随着世界的需要，我们可以弹性的为各国的需要或者是世界国际社会的需要来调整。那接下来我们是不是请政委来针对刚刚董事长的发言？
对，其实这样子的概念不是新概念了，好像11世纪就开始有了。我去梵蒂冈的时候，参加联合国永续发展网络的会议的时候，有去造访那个马耳他骑士团。马耳他骑士团就是这样子的一个sovereign entity without portfolio， 然后它成立的目的就是马耳他骑士团 is helping 啊，所以我们当然也可以成为一个2300万人的马耳他骑士团，好像也不错。对，那不过我想要讲另外一件事情，就是说这些新的这种我 们叫做 hybrid organization， 就是说它里面有一些主权实体的成分，但更多的是多方利害关系人，就是每一个参加的人啊的这个成分。这个其实是国际秩序上面每一次当你要碰到一些跨国性的问题，举例来讲气候变迁，因为二氧化碳不会坐下来跟你谈判，或者是大的流行病像现在这个状况，又或者是说假讯息的危害啊，这些就是说凡是它不是属于这个国境能够打住的东西，那它是全球性的东西，你就需要所有跟这个利益攸关的、权益攸关的这些各方真的坐下来谈。对所有的国家而言，实际上住在海岸边的那些受到气候变迁最先影响的，他们之间彼此之间互相关心的程度，说不定还高过同一个国家里面内陆部分的这些省份对于这些沿岸部分省份关心的程度。所以，新的国际秩序确实是正在形成了。那我们在这个过程里面，当然我也常常举那个我们在现在也已经一周年了嘛，我们不是有一个专法嘛？那个时候就是同婚的专法在设计的时候，不是被逆称叫做超连结专法啊，就是说我们把民法里面关于结婚的部分，就是个人的权利的义务的部分，通通都超连结过去。那但是民法里面关于家族的部分，就是结姻的部分、家族亲属的部分，都没有超连结过去。那这样子的情况下，我们就创立了一个叫结婚不结姻，这个也是社会创新，因为很多别的亚洲国家听说原来还有这一套，我们之前倡议都搞错方向。对，那这个就一下子就争取了很多跨世代的认同，那到现在认同的人变得越来越多。那所谓专法优于民法，当然当时是一个口号了，并不是说它真的优于民法，有很多问题现在正在一一解决。但是因为它是一个专法，它有优于民法的可能性，就是你可以多加一些新的概念在里面，多加一些新的可能性在里面。那所以在这个过程里面，我们也发现说，哎，其实不管是像美国的台湾关系法，我们跟纽西兰包含原住民族对原住民族 NSTEC 里面的那一章。等等，这些都是传统这个西法利亚体系不会特别去想的东西，因为西法利亚体系是一个很固着的一个体系。但是当你是透过这样子一个甚至是不是双边，而是从一个感染爆发的地方跟另外一个感染爆发的地方，有这个非常具体的这个 epicenter to epicenter relationship 啊，这个也是我们现在外交部具体在经营的这样一种 relationship。那这样子的东西，其实它很可能可以跳脱出那种200个国家投票，然后我们就一直输的那个状况，我们可以有。很多个这个从8个到18个主权实体投票，那我们一直赢的这样子一个情况会出现。所以我真的觉得说这样子一个新的概念啊，就是超脱西法利亚体系的概念，我真的很高兴我们大使也是这样子概念的支持者，我们以前没有在这个主题上面这样对话过。
好，那非常感谢两位啊，充分的讨论，特别是从一些创新的概念啊，无论是国家主权的角色，或者是说社会上各种不同的创新概念在台湾偶然的机会之间发现它的潜力，那所以有机会在未来可能带来更多的创新，特别是我们在这个社会创新实验中心的各种团队，我们邀请类似詹董事长或是我们政委，其实每个礼拜三在这边也都跟不同的团队，无论是脑力激荡，或者是解决他们的问题，或者是去思考法律上面有一些法规是不是如何松绑或者做调整的一个政务委员的角色，可以说在这边有很多新的事情发生。那詹董事长之前曾经提过，创新，特别是社会创新或者是产业的新创啊，那应该是国家要提供给年轻人或者是中小企业机会的一个政策啊。那我想特别在刚刚的发言里看到这样的机会，所以非常感谢两位啊，在刚刚一个钟头的时间当中，可以说谈到非常多的面向，但基本上综合了这次从疫情引发，我们看见其实过去我们每一次发生台湾无论是在外交上面，无论在国际社会上面被排挤或打压的时候呢，总是满腹的委屈。可是经过这个疫情，好像突然发现，也因为我们习惯这种事情的打压，而生出了各种各样生存的能力，在国际社会里面，反而在这样的情境里面产生新的不同的可能性。那我想这可能性会继续的延续下去。好，我们非常再次感谢两位大师在刚刚给我们做的分享哦。那接下来要稍微请各位稍待一下，我们要准备一下接下来的那个座谈会。那所以我们请两位先回座。那 等一会儿我们会邀请三分钟的休息时间，那我们会邀请我们两位法国跟澳洲的代表上来跟我们一起座谈，所以请大家稍微休息一下 ，take a rest for a while before we prepare the panel discussion, chairs and tables.Respectively from France and Australia to be with us, our digital minister Audrey Tang and Chairman Chen. So for this session, we would like to invite our international friends to give us your observation and experiences during this pandemic, especially on the coping strategy of ourGovernment and the whole society on the COVID-19. So let's begin with Representative Gawan.
Well, thank you very much, Secretary General, for the invitation to participate today. Let me acknowledge Minister Tang, also Chairman Chan. Thank you very much for having us. And,请原谅我，我今天没有准备有国语，所以希望可以原谅。Look, my topic today is about Australia and how we're in Australia harnessing technology, but also trying to protect privacy as we tackle COVID-19. So I'm going to show slides every so often. I don't know whether Chairman Jan could help from time to time. But every so often I have a slide. 谢谢 So look, let me first say that Taiwan has done a remarkable job. You know, Taiwan's response to COVID has really been very impressive. And I think we've hearda very interesting discussion between Minister Tang and also Chairman Chan about some of the ways in which COVID-19 might change the way we interact as a society and even change business and government too. And of course, all of that is very important. But, you know, right from management of the border, management of quarantine, to the use of masks, both for medical reasons but also for social reasons, the use of big data, the use of electronic fencing to monitor people in quarantine and isolation, all of it has been very impressive. And so Taiwan does have a lot of great experience to share. And, you know, for that reason, this is a difficult graph to see, but it's worth looking at. It's a logarithmic scale. So every line is 10 times as many cases as before. So you can see that Taiwan really is leading the world. Taiwan's at the bottom. That's a good chart to be the bottom of. However, I do want to say that Australia is also being quite successful. And I suppose that's what I want to tell you a little bit about today. We've had quite a lot of success flattening the curve, making it, acting early and acting firmly. And as you can see, our cases are around the 7,000 mark, many more than Taiwan, but we've got tiny growth now, less than 0.5%, 0.2% growth. And new cases are pretty much all imported or have very clear transmission history, so we can effectively isolate them. Now, our success in Australia, I think, is built on a few things. One, of course, is a really good, robust public health system, and that's important. Also, very effective border measures, which we brought in quite early and firmly. One more innovation, I think, is a new cabinet structure. So Australia is a federation. We're a huge country, as the speaker's notion before. We're 220 times the size of Taiwan, so we're absolutely massive, even though we have the same population as you. And we have eight territory and state governments, each with their own legal competence. So one innovation from this has been to bring together in a single national cabinet the leaders and health ministers from all these jurisdictions plus the federal government into one decision-making body. It has considered the best practice from around the world. It's taken decisions very quickly, and it's communicated with the people very clearly. All of those have been very important. Needless to say, another innovation, it has been meeting virtually, online. And at the height of the crisis, it was every day, meeting every single day. Now it's meeting about once every 2 weeks. But I think that is a decision-making body that we will take forward now. It's been something we've learned from the crisis about how good it can be, and we're going to take it into other fields of public policy now. One more thing to say is that our economic stimulus package is working. It's one of the biggest in the world at 11% of GDP, but that has given a lot of confidence to the people. Now look, beyond that, Australia has also used some important technological solutions. One of these is our testing response. So our COVID-19 testing effort is one of the world's most extensive. We've taken more than 1.4 million tests, but we only have positive diagnoses for 0.5% of those. So that's to say we're testing nearly 200 people to find one positive COVID test. Now, there's only one country in the world that's testing at a higher proportion than us, and that's New Zealand. You in Taiwan are just behind us. And then a fair bit further down is South Korea. We're kind of the places that are doing testing at those kind of high rates. And what that means is that, we've really mobilized health technology, spread it widely, so we're not just targeting a very narrow band of people with suspected cases. We really are capturing, anyone who could really have the virus. One more area where Australia is a world leader is in medical science. We've been a leader in this field for many decades now, and in COVID, it's no exception. So the Peter Doherty Institute was the first place in the world outside China to replicate successfully the COVID virus in a cell. And this is our Commonwealth Science and Industrial Research Organization manipulating that virus very carefully. More than 20 Australian researchers participate on what's called the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovation. So this is a global task force and works around the world to develop vaccines. And very early on, they were using a vaccine candidate developed at the University of Queensland that went into testing just 3 weeks after this development, so in mid-February. Of course, we're working with Taiwan partners too. Trungpa University and Monash University are researching a drug together called ivermectin, which could be a good COVID treatment. They're also working together on other antiviral treatments for things like dengue, Zika, and influenza. Also, Taiwan's TLC is working with an Australian company called Novatech and another one called Nucleus. So these are doing clinical trials for COVID-19, a drug candidate, TCL-19. We're doing similarly with US companies too. A further area of innovation is one that many countries are trying to, but we've, I think, pioneered some innovation in apps for people in coronavirus. So in late March, the Australian government Thank you very much. The Australian government launched what we've called the coronavirus app. So this is a single window for all official information on coronavirus. In Australia, it's the single reliable source of official information on the virus. And this is one of the important things we've discovered, is having a trusted place you can direct people to so that there's less chance for misinformation. So it includes things, you know, all the epidemiology, of course, the case numbers, where they are, that sort of thing. But it also offers people a symptom checker. It offers people, you know, some mental health support, particularly if they're in isolation. This is quite important. It provides the latest news. It provides information on economic support that you and your company can get. So this has been a quite an important development. It's, I think, your recently released COVID-19 chatbot has some of the similar functions there. And then, even more recently, our government has released a second app. So this is called the COVID Safe app. And basically, this is a contact tracing app. It uses a technology that's a bit similar to Singapore's Trace Together app, but it has some new features that are designed to address privacy and data storage concerns that have been raised in certain places. So unlike technology and apps that have been used in some jurisdictions around the world, this app doesn't track your location. It doesn't use GPS data, it doesn't use base station data. What it does is that when two people have the app installed, it uses Bluetooth. And if I'm within 1.5 meters of a friend, then our phones make a digital handshake, and it records how long we met, the distance, and the duration, and it records my contact's code. This is a code that changes regularly, so it's not attributable. It's not going to identify a person, and the information is then stored on the phone, encrypted, but it's deleted every 21 days. So there's quite a lot of privacy built in. This app is voluntary. So we've tried to persuade the Australian public to download it. So far, 6 million Australians have in the month it's been released. The location's not tracked or disclosed to others. And if there's a positive case, then that information is given to the health authorities. They contact the person who has contracted the virus and then check whether they consent to their data being sent to the central repository and onto people they've been in contact with. So there are some privacy considerations built into the development of technology in Australia. Some countries are adopting a similar approach now, and I think we'll build on it and even improve what we've done. And I believe Apple and Google have also developed their own digital handshake apps, which use Bluetooth as well, and are building on some of the features developed in our experience. Finally, like the Social Innovation Lab, like your Social Innovation Lab, Australia's Digital Transformation Agency played a major role coordinating our response to COVID, and I think in the future it will continue to play an important role, especially in, you know, making the most of interconnected technologies, the Internet of Things, 5G, artificial intelligence, and so and that will be for the benefit of the Australian government. So I think with Taiwan, with France, with other partners around the world, I think we have a lot of valuable experiences to share with each other, and I'm confident there'll be new opportunities, new technologies emerge, whether that's in the vaccine space or whether that's in the digitization space, I think, you know, we'll be learning a lot from each other. And if you permit me, I'll finish with a short 成语, 休戚相关, 患难与共. Thank you.
Thank you. And before I hand the microphone to our friends from France, we found Americans watching. Let's welcome AIT Director Li Yingjie. 我们李大使来了。 So, floor is yours.
Thank you. I'm very happy to be here with you today. And thank you, Mr. Fang. And thank you very much, Chamanda, for inviting us. Thank you, Gary, for what you said. And I just can agree with you the way you ended. We need to work together, and we will. We are still doing. The first thing I wanted to mention, which is very important for me,
is
Taiwan can help.
Yes.
And for helping, you need to be a member of the global community, of the global society. And Taiwan is a member of the global society. And this is the way it is happening. Two consequences. The first one is that, of course, France was supporting and will support Taiwan in the WHO. And specifically as an observer of the WHO Assembly. This is necessary for Taiwan, for us. We need to share the experience, we need to share the knowledges, we need to share the tools, we need to share the money to help the poorest countries. So we have to be all on board, and Brent was just there, but he left already. We consider it France, and not only France, like-minded countries like Australia, of course, do, that together we are stronger, and acting alone against the COVID doesn't help. So we will go on supporting, in a way or another, Taiwan working with us at the WHO, and that's very important. The second point, which is as much important in my view, is that Taiwan experience in our world is very strong and very important because it needs success. There is one aspect, Gary was describing the different technical success, of different technical reason of the success of the fight against the pandemic in Taiwan. But it is very important for us to consider that Taiwan did that being a strong, vivid democratic society. And this is of course very, very important because you know there was at one time a narrative saying that to fight the COVID to be efficient, you have not to be a democracy. So when Taiwan is winning against the COVID, as it is doing now, as a democracy, it is very important for us that this is an example for the whole world. So, in that way too, Taiwan is happy, no doubt. Of course, as you know, we faced in Europe and in France a very different situation and very different even from Australia, because the pandemic arrived very violently in Europe, and we were not ready for that. Frankly speaking, we didn't have the SARS experience. You had the tragedy you experienced in 17 years ago. And on the contrary, in France, we had the opposite as an experience. It was in 2009, I think, another epidemic, which was H1N1, if I'm not wrong. And at that time, France has been spending billions of euros buying masks and vaccine, and it was useless. And at that time, there was criticized against the government of that time to say that they are spending money for no reason. And at that time, there was a decision which was taken to disarm against that kind of risk. And this is one of the main reasons why we were not ready this winter to face that situation. And we reacted in a kind of panic, frankly speaking. And for that reason, the use of digital tools could not be the same here in Taiwan than what it was in France. Because for part of them, it was already too late. This is one very important aspect I wanted to describe for you. And the second point, which is very important to have in mind, is that in France, there is a kind of distrust against digital tools regarding the protection of personal data. And during the lockdown, when there was the idea of using personal digital tools to identify the people who are infected or who could be infected, there was a huge debate, and there still is a huge debate. We are French, so when there's a question, we have a huge debate, always. it's very important because we are speaking about human rights, about personal freedoms, and the respect of it. So it was a strong discussion. In the end, this week, our digital minister, Senator, succeeded in making the law, voted, approved by the parliament after the approval of some independent commission, which was very important, say, as lawyers and specialists of digital tools, to say that this tool could be authorized. The parliament agreed, and it will be operated beginning on Monday. This tool is called Stop COVID. Recognizing the concern expressed by right groups, the government based the app on 5 fundamental principles: use of voluntary basis, respect for private life, anonymity, transparency, and temporary disposal, which are different characteristics which were taken used for solutions in Taiwan too, and I can tell you we have been reporting with my team very much about Taiwanese experience on that, to say you can use that kind of tool still being a democracy. Good. The app allows you to be notified immediately if you have been in contact less than 1 meter for at least 15 minutes the last few days with someone who has just tested positive for COVID-19. And like in Taiwan, the app uses Bluetooth technologies, and the application does not use the location of people by GPS data from mobile phone, and therefore the application will not be able to tell where a person has been. And another aspect which is very important for us is the European dimension of the project, because our government is deeply attached to the notion of digital sovereignty. And maybe you know that we have been decided in France not to use the solution proposed by Apple and Google to track contact cases, for the reason that we considered that it was not giving enough guarantees on the protection of personal data. So referring to this, to the question, how can Taiwan help? Speaking of France specifically, I can say that we French should study the way Taiwan managed to build the consensus on the use of that kind of tool. That we know that Taiwanese do care about the respect of human rights as much as we do, and maybe even more. So your example is very important for us, and I'm waiting for French journalists to come here and to see how it works, how you did, and how did the population deal with that kind of tool in a very democratic society. This is very important in my view. And the second aspect of the use of innovation in France that I wanted to describe for you is the action, the initiative coming from the society, from the whole society, and supported by public authorities, of course. You know that the big French companies have been reacting very quickly. Air Liquide, who is very strong in here in Taiwan and other parts of the world, has been building ventilators, for example. Fashion brands like Chanel and Dior quickly switched their production to make sanitizer, protective personal equipment for hospital and personal in the hospital. But the startups have been writing very quickly too. Local initiative, local proposal, local solutions. And so one thing which was important, I will give maybe first some example. A startup like DoctorLib is a platform dedicated to booking medical doctors. And the platform has allowed all doctors to use the video platform free of charge. And this was an easy way and a free way to get access to the doctors, which was very, very important, of course, and still is. Another example is the crowdfunding platforms created special emergency packages with goods and label for the neediest. The projects were on NGO platforms such as the Red Cross. The government did his best to help the startups, making known their proposals. Maybe you are familiar with the French Tech initiative. The French Tech is a proposal of startups to organize together and to be more efficient. And you have French Tech in France, in Paris, in every city and region, and abroad in different countries. And the French Tech in Taiwan, I'm happy to say that it is the most dynamic in Asia, considered from the Ministry for Numeric Issues in Paris. So we are doing a very good job with them too. And together with the French Tech, we have been creating a platform to list all opportunities to help a startup in various aspects of its work against COVID-19. I'm just learning that COVID in French should be la COVID and not le COVID. And this is not sexism. This is for scientific reason, I cannot explain. But this is true. Anyway, in English it's COVID-19. As a diplomat, of course, I'm working for having the best cooperation we can. So we know in the innovation society community that there is no border and there is no solution in working alone. So as a diplomat, of course, I'm just helping this cooperation, which is natural in the innovation community. And we are working with Taiwan to make French and Taiwanese developers knowing each other and developing each other's experience. I understand my time is up, so I will go very quickly. So we will go on working together on that field, together with the French Tech, as I said. We will go on helping, building bridges between the innovation community here in Taiwan and in France too. And another aspect I wanted to describe, that 2 weeks ago I was in visiting the chairman of NIH LI, and we were discussing about scientific cooperation between the Institute and INSEM, which is a partner in France, another like Institut Pasteur. But one of the topics we discussed was how to have French and Taiwanese startups taking part in the development of an industrial process of solutions, of scientific solutions against the virus. Tests and medical solutions too. So this is very important. So for ending, I would say that Taiwan can help. We know it. We need them. We need you. And we will go on working together, fighting against the COVID. Thank you very much. Xixie.
Thank you. Thank you for welcoming again. I just found that the Chinese translation of your name. Essentially, usually refer to a smart consultant. that people used Gong Shen Meng, 听起来就是一个很厉害的军师的名字。And it's very apparent from your experiences that you just shared with us. So, Representative Gao Wen and Director Castle Boone just shared a lot of important insight on the electronic fences, human rights issues, privacy issues, protection of personal data. And for now, I would like to give the microphone to Audrey on what is your response to the experiences from these two countries and the insights we learned from them.
Okay, thank you. It was great listening to the shared values that we have, that is to say, to empower the society, empower the democracy amidst the coronavirus, having an open response to the virus and having an open recovery without resorting to authoritarianism, state surveillance on one side and capitalist surveillance on the other side. I think that is a shared value between our countries that is evident. When I became digital minister, which was almost 4 years ago now, 3.5 years ago, the HR department asked me, because it's a new position, what is my job description? And I said, this is very simple. It's just these three sustainable development goals, the SDGs 17-18, 17-17, 17-6, meaning reliable data, effective partnerships, and open innovation. And we can see that spirit in the tales that we tell about our own democracies and how to strengthen those. Of course, at that time, the HR people tells me, Minister, the SDGs was just introduced, because that was 2016, and SDGs was introduced 2015, and you expect people to memorize those numbers. That's not possible. And so they asked me to write in plain language what I mean by those three numbers. So I will recite my job description just as a response to our shared values. My job description still is my job description, goes as follows. When we see the Internet of Things, let's make it an Internet of Beings. When we see virtual reality, let's make it a shared reality. When we see machine learning, let's make it a collaborative learning. When we see user experience, let's make it about human experience. And whenever anyone tells us that the singularity is near, let us always remember the plurality is here. And a plural democracy, a liberal democracy, I think that is precisely why we choose the kind of values for our technologies that strengthens the social sector, that strengthens social innovation, and not the authoritarian or capitalist responses as other jurisdictions have also amplified during the coronavirus crisis there. And so I think this is about choice. And so we talked about the French digital minister. I just had a conversation with the French digital ambassador, so the French equivalent of ambassador Jean Hongzhi, Henri Verdier. We just had a workshop not too long ago at the Open Response of the Recovery workshop in the Open Government Partnership, and we shared our ideas around how to make sure that everybody can innovate in the kind of technologies that does the contact tracing, for example. And we both agreed that the idea of accountability is of utmost importance. Accountability meaning that whenever anyone has any fear, uncertainty, or doubt, we the technologists is our problem if we cannot explain it in plain language, if we keep insisting on using, you know, 17.17 or 17.5, that's our problem, because then we cannot get a full account out to the people. And I think Australia has done an exemplary job explaining how that works. I just pasted some comics that describe how the contact tracing app works to this live stream, because people were wondering how would you even do that without GPS access. And so there's excellent comic books, there's excellent interactive games that comes out of the international research community. And that's accountability. That's getting people the right informed knowledge of how epidemiology works. It's treating the social sector as adults, right? As people who have their own decision-making capabilities, and they can make improvements if you understand the underlying epidemiology. This is a sense that prompted previously VP academician Chen Qingren to record that crash course epidemiology is the same spirit that whenever our CCC commander, Minister Chen Shizhong, whenever anyone tells him a new idea, even though it may be a very wild or crazy idea, he always says, oh, you should have told me that sooner. Or, oh, we can learn from it. Or would you elaborate? And so he never says, it's a stupid idea. He never says that, right? So he always prompts social innovation, even though it was in a very early stage. And that makes sure that anybody with an almost crazy idea, like you should wear pink medical mask, can pick up their phone and call 1922 and tell that to the CECC. And the CECC actually does that the very next day. And so that, I think, is the accountability that we're looking for both during and after the pandemic, that people would now expect their liberal democracy governments to respond in various other ways in the here and now, as we have done during the pandemic. And I think that will share our digital culture that is empowering the citizens, making the state transparent to the citizens, not citizens transparent to the state, the international norm after this pandemic. And this will be a resurgence of the important ideas of liberal democracy post-pandemic, because this is too important to lose. Thank you.
Thank you for the sharing from two ambassadors. It's very inspiring that I learned from your sharing that I think the cases in New Zealand, Australia, or Taiwan prove that democratic society actually are able to respond to a pandemic successfully. I mean, without using strong forces or sacrificing the human rights, I think that a particular important characteristic of a democratic society is the transparency of all the decision-making, public decision-making, or the free flow of the information. I mean, as a citizen in Taiwan, I would say that during the whole pandemic, I'm very proud of that my society keep a very transparent information environment to all the citizens. That means that we are quite sure that what is going on. We feel safe, we feel comfortable, because our Minister of Health, he hold a press conference every day at 2 p.m. Then we know whether there's a new confirmed cases. And he even will explain what that particular cases is all about, and we have lots of information about the situation. So we understand where to buy the mask, we understand the availability of the mask, and we know the footprints of other confirmed cases in order to match with our own footprint. We understand what is the risk we are taking, or what should we do. In responding to the situation, if I have a footprint matches with the certain confirmed cases, then I should be self-quarantined, or I should ask for the doctor's help. So not only Taiwan is safe, I think people are feeling comfortable. I think that's more important, even more important than safe itself. So, in the democratic society, some of the society are hitting hard, been hit hard by the pandemic, like the cases in the United States, in Italy, or Spain. But they are democratic society. So people understand all the situation. They know all the information. They understand they are in a dangerous situation, so they can respond or behave accordingly. I think that's different from if you cover up all the things and ask people to follow the orders. I think it's different. I think that people feeling safe or feeling unsafe is the way to fight a pandemic. That in the democratic societies, we are doing all the behavior, we are having all the behaviors according to the information, to the free flow of the information. I think that's the difference. And then we share the common values. So I would say that after this pandemic, I think that there might be a huge change in terms of political, geographical landscape, even the international relationship among countries might change a little bit, or not a little bit, might change a lot. But for example, China already say that they will not buy wines and beer from Australia. I hope that Taiwan can buy more Australian wines without sacrificing the French wines. after this pandemic, there must be a new way of airlines, and there must be certain way that all the countries that share the same values have to help each other, have to join together, not only for the public health aspect, but also for fighting all other social problems. After this, we learn a lesson that we should try to communicate more and understand more about each other and what kind of efforts they are offering, and we understand who we can learn from. So it's not Taiwan can help. I think Australia can help. France can help. We all help each other. I think that the pandemic bring the friends even closer. I think that's the way I'm looking at this aspect.
Thank you, Chairman Zhang. I think you mentioned about the collective behavior actually depends on their sense of security, which builds upon the mutual trust between the people and the government and creates a lot of positive cycle over the process. And any inputs or insights from the two of you, Representative Kao?
Yeah, look, thank you very much. I think the clear communication from a government to its people has turned out to be incredibly important, both so people know what the right thing to do is, but also because that engenders confidence. And helps the government actually win over the sort of cooperation of its people. I think one thing that's been important in Australia, and I think Taiwan and other places that are managing it well, is that governments who have been prepared to listen to experts, the people, you know, the scientists, the epidemiologists who really know what's going to happen and then have been prepared to act quickly, they have done better than some other jurisdictions. So listening to the experts and putting that in place, I think, is an important role for government. It's not everything is an eternal debate. A second thing is that, the international system has not been working as well as we would want. You know, there's the virus, I think, could have had us all working together very well, but what's happening is very far short of that. So, you know, we do need to be working together as much as possible, sharing information, sharing scientific knowledge, sharing vaccines. Also, I think continuing to share trade. This is very important. You know, there's a big push. Okay, everything needs to come back home. We can't possibly trust anyone else to make things for us. But actually, if you are prepared to keep trading with your important partners, this is very significant. So, you know, Taiwan has been very good about, you know, sending masks and other things overseas. Australia too is really working hard to keep trading lines open. So, you know, we are selling you imported food, we're selling you medical alcohol, you know, there's things that you need that we are still providing, and keeping those lines open is very important at this time.
Yes, indeed. Thanks.
Merci. I can only agree with you, Gary, what you said. And one lesson of this crisis is solidarity and global solidarity between different countries and continents and between people. And I want to mention the Taiwanese companies and people who made donation, and not only the government did, but it was one donation in between many other ones, and that was very important for us, of course, and for the French people. And the second thing I wanted to say is that in a living crisis, it can be something to learn or something good to come, and something good to come for Taiwan in Europe and in France especially is that everybody knows Taiwan, everybody loves Taiwan now because of that example, because of those donations and that solidarity. Not only Taiwan has been identified for many people in France, it was not necessarily easy to know exactly where was Taiwan and what it was. And now it's identified as a very modern society, which was already the case mainly 1 year ago when the same-sex wedding was adopted. We realized that there was a society community here in Asia, in the Far East, which was sharing the same values. And then this autumn, this winter, during the election, while in the same time Hong Kong was facing such difficult times, we had a democratic process which worked very well and which was followed closely in France and in Europe. And third time now, we all face the same crisis, and Taiwan is so successful and such a good example. So this very much helped to give a very strong and very positive image to Taiwan. So that's very cool for me to be in Taiwan. Thank you.
And I think last but not least, we've been hearing a lot of encouraging messages, and at Taiwan Can Help, a lot of experiences we share the next to many countries. And you can observe that younger generations are eager to participate in the international community. What are your advices for us? Not, you know, in preparing us to become part of the international community, and what kind of lessons we need to be aware on the way to come to rejoin to the international community.
I mean, for the young generation, the main thing is, and it's difficult to say it now, but I will say it anyway, travel. Have other experiences, meet other people of your own age, study abroad. I have to say that we in France, we have more or less the same number of Taiwanese students than we have Japanese students or Korean students. But the population is not the same. So already Taiwanese are traveling in France and studying in France much more than other countries in Asia, but you have to do that more and share experiences and learn from each other. And of course, when you learn from us, we learn from you in the same time. So this is very important. Startups, I mentioned it, we need to develop contacts between the startups, and we are doing it. So discovering each other, that's very important, I think.
Look, my answer would be quite similar. I think obviously travel is hard at the moment, but as soon as flights reopen, I would encourage young Taiwanese not only to go to France, but also to go to Australia. study, start a business there, or do working holiday maker, all those sorts of things. I think every year we have maybe 20,000 of you doing that. Of course, we would like to keep that growing. And I think what I've observed, this program has been in place about 15 years, and it's meant that now as I move around the island, almost every town I go to, I'll find a couple of people who have studied in Australia or have worked in Australia, and it creates more familiarity. It means that your young people are used to dealing with the world. They're used to working not only in Woiwu, but also in English. They've got more work experience, they've got new ideas. For a long time, young Taiwanese have thought, I think, only of America. And of course, America's impressive and important to see, but it's not the only place. So my pitch is also consider other places. And secondly, of course, as I said before, be very open-minded on trade and investment. I think Taiwan still could open up a fair bit more. You're so impressive with the IT industry, semiconductors and so on, but there are other areas I think where it would be useful for you to open up more in the future, whether that's the financial sector, whether that's agricultural, whatnot, and become much more internationally connected and export oriented. Thank you.
Thank you. Those are very excellent answers and encouragement for us, especially young people. So let's travel and travel and travel. Thank you all for your time and coming to our panel discussion and come to the Social Innovation Center. Thank you. 谢谢。我们非常感谢大家的参与，也感谢我们收看直播的所有观众。谢谢大家。我们今天的座谈就到这边，谢谢。